Welcome everybody to the fifth webinar series on biodiversity conversations. This series is being sponsored by the Office of the Principal Scientific Advisor, the National Biodiversity Authority, and the Biodiversity Collaborative. I am Darshan Shankar, the moderator of this webinar, and I work in the Transdisciplinary University as its Vice Chancellor. The focus of today's webinar is on biodiversity and health, valorizing medicinal plants and traditional knowledge for human welfare in the 21st century. We have already received questions from some of the participants who have registered. We welcome more questions. Please use the question and answer box function to pose your questions, not the chat box. And to those questions which we cannot answer because of shortage of time, we will reply to such questions by email. This program is being streamed live on Facebook, and it will be shortly uploaded also on the YouTube. The next webinar in the series will be on the 6th of October, and that is going to be on exploration, discovery, and genetic characterization of biodiversity, and it will address the lineage, the Linnean shortfall. I want to thank the sponsors of this series, and of course, I want to in advance thank the eminent speakers who have agreed to share their generous time for this webinar. So I will begin by giving you a quick look at the various components of the National Biodiversity Mission. Kareem, can you please? There are 8 components, and the logos of these components are shown on the screen. The first component is called Nisarg Bharat. It is about cataloging, mapping of life of India. So it covers many, many facets of biodiversity, and it's a cataloging and mapping of these different facets of biodiversity. A second component is on biodiversity and ecosystem services. A third is on climate change and disaster risk management. A fourth component is on biodiversity and agriculture. A fifth component is on One Health and zoonosis, very relevant in the present context of COVID. The component we are today discussing in the series is medicinal plants and health and livelihood security. There's a component on biodiversity and bioeconomy. And there is then finally a component on biodiversity capacity building and outreach. So these are the 8 sort of components of NBM. I won't try to explain each of these components, but conversations will be happening on each of these components. But you can see that the PSA office has supported this kind of a initiative with all these components. So I will straightaway now come to the component that is in discussion in the webinar today, which is on focused on medicinal plants. This particular component on medicinal plants has got the following features, and some of these will be presented during the course of this webinar. The first feature will be a citizens portal on medicinal plants of India. This is going to be a portal in which medicinal plants used in various systems of medicine will be uploaded, and you can search for the occurrence of these plants at any geographic level, in a taluka, in a town, in a city, in a state. So it's searchable. It is a citizens portal. It will be interactive. It will invite contributions from citizens as well. And there will be a fairly detailed presentation on this portal during this webinar. A second component of this medicinal plant program in the National Biodiversity Mission is on health security. This is a component in which, of course, the citizens portal will be of immense value, because people in every taluka and therefore in every village in India can look up the occurrence of plants that are located in their taluka. And of course, the portal will have information on the referenced uses of these plants for human health, for animal health, as well as for crop health. And this sort of information will empower local communities and contribute to their health security. So we expect that this component will usher in what we refer to as the fourth tier in the national health system. So far, the national health system is an institutionally driven system of primary, secondary, tertiary care. But this will be a fourth tier which will empower citizens to take care of certain aspects of primary health care of humans, animals, and crops by themselves. That's what the citizens portal will help, and therefore this dimension of health security. There is also going to be a national herbarium and raw drug repository of medicinal plants. A national herbarium already exists in the Transdisciplinary University campus in Bangalore, and it will be further strengthened and also added on will be an extract library. This will be a very unique herbal extract library. It will not be a library of molecules, but it will be a library of extracts from classical formulations that are used in traditional systems of medicine. So it will be a very unique kind of an extract library. The National Center for Biological Sciences in Bangalore and TDU will, along with other research institutions, develop this extract library. Livelihood security is another component, because this entire National Biodiversity Mission is meant for supporting human welfare. And so the PSA office was very, very keen to see that we are not merely documenting, creating portals and so on and so forth, but all the programs that are developed must impact communities, must impact society. And so health security, I've already explained. There will also be a component on livelihood security. And we hope that the pilots that will be done in the National Biodiversity Mission will give inspiration for the growth of a herbal, community-based herbal enterprises on the Amul model you know, as we know, Amul is the most successful model where millions of farmers are benefited, and they are suppliers of the milk, and the milk is processed and so on and so forth, and they have a stake in it. So we hope that the National Biodiversity Mission initiative on livelihood security will spark something like an Amul model for the herbal sector. We expect that both in the health security and livelihood security programs, we will collaborate with national bodies like the National Medicinal Plants Board, which really is the national nodal agency for these kinds of initiatives. Another dimension will be on innovative strategies for in situ conservation. There is going to be a presentation in the webinar on what are the innovative aspects of in situ conservation that will be executed, that are visualized to be executed under this component on medicine plants. The last two components of this mission on medicinal plants will be building a South Asian network of organizations across South Asia, because historically there has been a tremendous amount of cooperation and collaboration over the centuries, ever since the 5th century BC, with countries in Asia, and India's medical heritage is sort of shared across the Asian region. You can see reflections of it from countries like China to Thailand, Burma, Mongolia, Indonesia, Vietnam. The idea is to build a South Asian network for the same theme of revitalizing medicinal plant conservation and valorizing traditional knowledge. Finally, all components of the National Biodiversity Mission will have provision for giving small grant projects and fellowships to large number of aspirants, so that the contribution from different sections of society, from different stakeholders, so it won't only be a few organizations that will lead this particular initiative. This will be an initiative in which we expect participation of agencies like the National Medicinal Plant Board. There will be linkages developed with the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library, which is one of the biggest sort of repositories of traditional knowledge in this country. There will be linkages with other government and non-government bodies, universities, and so on and so forth. So it's a very open-ended kind of a mission, only being coordinated by the Biodiversity Collaborative. And I'll stop here and invite now the next speaker. The next speaker in the webinar is Dr. Professor JLN Shastri. I refer to him as professor because he has been a teacher, a professor in academia. He's also been working in the private sector, and he has the advantage of insights both in academics, in government sector, in private sector, and is currently in an extremely important position as the CEO of the National Medicine Plant Board, which is the nodal agency for so many dimensions of medicinal plants in the country. Over to you, Dr. Shastri. Can you unmute Dr. Shastri, please?
Yeah. I hope my screen is visible here.
Very clear.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Darshanji, for the kind introduction. indeed, it's my pleasure to be part of this webinar. rather I'm very much include the way the things are happening with the TDU and the association between TDU and NMPP is there for quite a long time, and a lot of projects have been taken up between us. And I'm glad that we are taking up this particular aspect related to biodiversity and the livelihood part, and again, the health security. And just I'll give a small brief of about 2 minutes what we are. We started our journey on 24th November 2000. And the mandate is to promote medicinal plants in this country. And we have the stakeholders as cultivars, collectors, supply chain intermediaries, and industry, research institutes, practitioners, our folk leaders, and international community. And the thrust areas for us are conservation, cultivation, research development, quality assurance, marketing and trade, IEC, and international cooperation. So we operate through our 7 RCFCs, the 7th one established a few days back at Pune University. Then we have 36 state medicinal plants boards, as well as the union territory. And we work with the state forest departments, horticulture and agriculture departments. And today, we are just trying to cover two aspects. I would like to give my perspective on these two aspects. A brief outline on NMPP programs and health and livelihood for the rural communities, and examples for focal species prioritized by the NMPP. So if we have to just look at what we are doing at present, NMPP is basically having two programs. One is the center sector scheme. The other one is the center sponsored scheme or the National Ayush Mission scheme. Under center sector scheme, we have conservation of medicinal plants and resource augmentation, R&D initiatives, and then our nurseries and herbal gardens and IEC anyway. That is part of both the schemes. When we look at the National Ayush Mission, we have medicinal plants cultivation and post-harvest management units, rural collection centers or district collection centers, and an SPV kind of marketing activity, like any entrepreneur groups. It can be FPO or an NGO or any individual farmer, they can farm this SPV and with the help of industry, and that's the activity which is available with us. So under the two schemes as they stand today, we have survey and inventorization, insect conservations, and we work with JFMCs, BMCs, and so on and so forth. This we have discussed. Today, I can probably say that we have more than 21,000 hectares of conservation and development area altogether. And the cultivation area is about 2,50,000 hectares altogether. And then when we look at the multiple examples, the focal species. As we all know, there are the documented 1178 species, out of which 500 are regularly used, are not regularly used, are used by industry. 350 species are commonly used, out of which 242 species, which are of high value. And among them, I have recently again further dwell into their own criticality. I understand about 83 species today would require our focus, whether it is a conservation or cultivation, would require specific focus, because they are into thousands of metric tons. So 100 metric tons going forward may not be a criteria. So we should look at different criteria, like the regulatory requirements, the biodiversity requirements, and trade requirements. Like just look at the Dacolopis, which was not on our scanner a few years back, and is there as a concern for many of us because the high volume uses. And an alternate species has become a red listed species. This is one of the good examples how high volume usage is a threat And maybe that's the point, the vulnerable point from where we start working on our species, then looking at anything else. So we will speak about that. And among those 83, we have 23 species which are exclusively either temperate or alpine, and another 8 species of our concern which are estuarine. So altogether, we have about 30 species which we need Himalayan states on a focused approach. So the purpose is to locate the endemic species of each region. That's more important. So as I mentioned, we have more than 21,000 hectares of conservation and development area. And I'm trying to slowly identify how much acreage is given to development area. Like in Gujarat, there is a development area also. This development area, we can specifically use for tapping Google in the coming years. That's one good advantage what we will have. Along with the conservation, we should also look at development. Every time looking at development is not going to do anything for us. So we should have a balanced activity. And I would like to take you through some of the successful stories of NMBB, which are often less discussed or often ignored, I would like to say. Sodium tolerant species. Those who cultivate medicinal plants along the Ganga belt, they are aware in Uttar Pradesh, the high salinity is a big problem. Look at Kushinagar, look at a place like Sandila and other areas. Today the problem is high sodium levels. So there are certain plant species which are sodium tolerant, and NMBB did a lot of studies. Look at Chitramul, look at Euryarchaea picta, look at Brahmi, Mandu, Pandi, look at even Khas, and look at Nagar Moth. These are the species on which NMBB did a lot of activity, and that gives a kind of contribution required for the farmers. And Brahat Panchmool is another one in which the germplasm was provided by TDU at that time, as I believe. Again, short-term high-density plantation, which is going to be very farmer-friendly and which gives a lot of livelihood. And we have taken it as a focus in the upcoming project. At least 1 lakh hectares is something what we are aiming right now, which gives the industry, not the bark, directly the root, which has similar properties like the bark. And it is sustainable, gives livelihood to the communities. And these are some of the successful models which are to be recognized. Like in situ conservation in Gujarat for Google. If you look at it, today we have more than 2,000 hectares of conservation come development area. Keeping the conservation area for our future, we should focus into the sustainable tapping of Google in the development area. This is something which is very important. Again, if you look at the ecotourism or the extensive conservation, the herbal garden actually developed by KFRA is one of the good examples in Kerala. Another important aspect which I would like to mention, many times we discuss about MMM Jammu and IHBT Palampur and even Jorhat when it comes to Astaburg, but NMBB also did good work on two of these species, Habanaria, and developed the good practices for the cultivation and commercialization. And the next 2 years to 2.5 years, our focus is on Astaburg. We have already discussed with the industry partners to sponsor one or the other projects. And we are also looking at entrepreneur groups among the farmers who can take it forward. So all these things, what I would like to say, going forward, the most important part is marketing. So within a couple of days, you will see a helpline with us. And we are also going to have a digital platform for us. Already it is designed. And it will be an end-to-end kind of facility. I have given the concept of seed to shelf. We'll start with the quality planting material and till it reaches the shelf where the manufacturer picks up, we will have the entire spectrum in which we help the farmer. That means he will become the part of this entire work. And this is another success story on our IAC training. This is something what I'm trying to mention and conclude. This is my last slide. What is the way forward? Many times we are looking at providing access benefit sharing to these communities and forget about it. Let us remember one thing. Lawlessness was not the problem or is not the problem what we are facing. We have 9 different forest related acts. It is right from your 1927 Forest Act, 72 Wildlife Act, and your Dwellers Act, so on and so forth. To name, there are more than 9 very good acts. In spite of all these things, your material from the forest is vanishing. We have efficient enforcement authorities. We have vulnerable communities living together in those areas from where these the resources are vanishing. So this is not going to be a solution. Solution is having proper link between the end user and the producer. So if you don't take up the tribes and farmers along with the industry, because no industry owner can get into a forest or in the cultivation field. They are all MBAs or something else who are sitting in the cities and they try to operate. So the best way is to take them together. So my suggestion would be there are 3-4 components, like 5% GST is being charged on jadi buti, okay, since the GST regime. So please look at how much of this is going back into the communities, which was not there when your Biodiversity Act is brought into picture. So it's a new one. Are we getting funds through this? That's one thing. Second, because this is happening already. The second thing, corporate CSR activities. The corporate CSR activities, look at ITC. ITC is having 15,000 hectares for various activities, including your eucalyptus, tobacco, so many things. So it's giving livelihood. Ease of business through voluntary registration. We have imposed a lot of requirements for access to the biomaterial, one registration for conducting R&D, one kind of approval for allowing them to commercialization, one, and for export, another one. Okay, so we need to bring it down, and then it leads to 100% increase in the income or livelihood, because the farmer is getting the money directly from the company. Okay, so the linkage is to the farmers is more important. That is buyback arrangement, forward integration, and that's all I would like to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shastri, for that presentation of extremely bold initiatives, very clear vision. And I think that the sector is going to really prosper, you know, with this kind of leadership. And we look forward to the National Biodiversity Mission working also in close cooperation with the NMPB. May I now invite the next speaker, which is Dr. Vishwajanani, who is the head of the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library, managed by the CSIR, Government of India. This is one of the largest repositories of traditional knowledge that we have in the country. And let's hear, a presentation from Dr. Vishwajanani. She has got 25 years of experience in research, in both the private and government sector, and has special interest in drug discovery. Over to you, Dr. Vishwajanani.
Thank you very much, Professor Shankar, for giving me this opportunity to share brief information on the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library on this very important platform. I guess most of the audience today who have joined us are much aware of the Haldigati, the patent on turmeric, and how India fought a long patent battle to make sure that the patent gets revoked. So the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library owes its birth to these patent wars that happened in the mid-90s. To give a few examples, I have just listed a few. The patent on turmeric, which was filed in 93, granted in 95 by the USPTO. The basmati rice lines, which was filed in 94 by a US company and granted in 97. And the fungicide formulation of neem, which was filed in 91, and which was again granted in the 94. So these are the patents that actually shook India, you know, because we have been relying on our traditional knowledge and taking things for granted that it is ours. But only when somebody else filed a patent and took ownership of it, we actually woke to a very difficult situation where, you know, if in case these patents were not to be revoked or amended, we would have had to seek permission of these owners to exercise these inventions. And that is what, you know, led to the birth of the TKDL. And in fact, you know, before the TKDL took its actual shape, I would say that, you know, it was the experts across the country who came together and, you know, with lots of evidence and paperwork and document and make sure that these patents on turmeric, the basmati lines, and as well as the neem were revoked and amended. It took anywhere between, you know, 3 to 12 years to fight this patent matter and made sure that we regain our traditional knowledge safe and sound. And as I said, the government of India under the leadership of the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research and Ministry of Ayush, along with the IPP then, worked together to create a task force, and out came the, you know, the idea of creating Traditional Knowledge Digital Library in view of the need for creating a prior art database on our traditional knowledge, because the most of the patent offices rely on what is called the PCT minimum documentation. And if in case our documents are not within this fold of the PCT minimum documentation, they are not considered by the patent examiners as prior art information. And that is what was largely led to these patents being filed in these patent offices internationally, and India fought a very bitter battle. And today I'm very proud to say that the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library, you know, which was set up way back in 2001, boasts of almost, you know, 4 lakh formulations from the Yunani, Siddha, Yoga, Ayurveda, and as well as Uvarigpa. And as one would know that, you know, the traditional knowledge information is from very different languages, be it Sanskrit, be it in our local regional languages such as Tamil, Bhoti, Malayalam, or Arabic, Persian. And all this information from these codified texts have been converted through what we call as traditional knowledge resource classification codes into a structured and, you know, much accessible information. And these are available now in English, French, German, Japanese, and Spanish. However, owing to the approvals of the government of India way back in 2016, the access of the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library is given only to the patent offices that have signed access agreements with the TKDL. And in addition to all this work, we also file pre-grant oppositions and third-party observations on patent applications that are filed on traditional knowledge. The key mandate of the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library is to prevent misappropriation of Indian traditional knowledge by vested interests. And as I mentioned, we are close to about 4 lakh formulations across the different streams of Indian systems of medicine, be it Ayurveda, Yunani, Siddha, Yoga, and Suvarikpa. We have covered close to about 380 books from across these systems of medicine and yoga as well. And I would say this is one of the largest digital libraries of traditional knowledge anywhere in the world. In fact, it was the first, and WIPO has been citing this as an example world over. And I'm very glad to also inform the audience here that owing to TKDL India, many countries such as Philippines, Thailand, Malaysia, and many others have also constituted their own TKDL along the lines of our own, and they have taken inspiration from us. And this is one of the very robust prior databases of traditional knowledge. And what forms the basis, as I said, is the medicinal formulations. And if we go back, you know, to our roots, you know, of the traditional systems of medicine, much of these systems of medicine is based on plant species. And you know, if you cover the overall Ayush systems of medicine, we have close to about 5,300 plants. And the folk based medicines, which are not part of the classical medicines, also is based upon, you know, 5,000 medicinal plant species. And I would like to say that the TKDL database is a very unique database that actually can provide correlation between the different systems of medicine, which are otherwise not available anywhere else. Say, for example, if I talk of Ayurveda, the Yunani, Siddha, Sova, Rigveda, and we also have a correlation with the common names that is used. We then correlate it with the botanical name. So here, this particular slide, I'll not go into the details of it, is just to give you an example that across the systems of medicine, we can identify plant species by its own name and as well as a common name that is typically used across even the modern sciences, and they are all correlated with the botanical names as well. And this is a rich source of even the medicinal plants, as you had, you know, very rightly mentioned. As I had mentioned, the main aim of the TKDL database is to prevent misappropriation of Indian traditional knowledge. So while the patent offices do use the TKDL database to the best effort, however, there are still certain applications that are missed by the patent examiners worldwide. So what the TKDL unit sitting in Delhi does is also file third-party observations and pre-grant oppositions on patent applications which seem to have relevance to our Indian traditional knowledge. And I'm very glad to say that we have, you know, achieved outcomes in almost about 239 cases, while we would have filed almost about 2,500 oppositions. What is very important from an Indian perspective is that while the other countries do not clearly demarcate between traditional knowledge and the modern knowledge, however, the Patents Act of 1970 of India does have a very clear rule where inventions that are not patentable is listed. And under that, the Section 3P says an invention which is in effect traditional knowledge, or it could be either solo or an aggregation of our traditional knowledge for known properties, this is all not patentable even by the Indian patent law. So we are, you know, doubly making sure that there is no misappropriation of our Indian traditional knowledge. So the TKDL database, while it serves the purpose of, you know, preventing and as a defensive protection of our traditional knowledge, the TKDL database also acts as a rich source of preserving and protecting our traditional knowledge. And I come to a very important slide that, you know, as I said, as on today, TKDL database is a defensive tool for protecting Indian traditional knowledge. But the National IPR Policy 2016 recommends that we open up the database more, both in terms of expansion of scope and as well as widening the access. And the TKDL unit, we are working towards that. So herein, we are trying to include, besides the Indian systems of medicine, even traditional agriculture, metallurgy, and also oral traditional knowledge. And here the oral traditional knowledge does have its own sensitivity because it is linked to people's livelihoods. So we are making sure that, you know, based on a free and prior informed consent, we will make sure that unless we receive the PIC from the knowledge holders, such information may not be documented. And if documented based on the consent given, it would be either treated confidential or open. And we are also working on widening the access of the TKDL database. But of course, this particular aspect would be subject to Government of India approvals, but the efforts are on. Moving forward, as I had mentioned, you know, with just one example where there is correlation of different botanicals across different streams of medicine, we see a large potential of the TKDL database in driving better health and wellness. And one is the enabling the traditional knowledge-inspired drug discovery and development. We are working on improving upon the ICT infrastructure of the TKDL database. There's an active program that is going on in TKDL right now. We are hoping that by harvesting the information on the traditional systems of medicine, we will be able to identify the commonalities and the synergies across the traditional knowledge in different streams of medicine. And if in case we can extend it to even the global traditional knowledge from other similar regions, we would be also able to identify the synergies and commonalities across the country, race, and ethnicity. This would help us, you know, to go across, go along, you know, the drug discovery and development, the development pathway, in a very fast mode, and it also lead to novelty based on our traditional knowledge across the globe, and it would also help us, you know, detect alerts and no-gos. In addition to that, you know, as most of our systems of medicine target holistic healthcare, we are looking to forward towards personalized medicine. And of course, wellness is a very important part of our traditional systems of medicine. We are looking at, you know, Ayush Ahar, where the dietary interventions captured from the traditional knowledge would also lead to standardization of such knowledge. And this can be used worldwide. And this would actually lead to the concept of food as medicine, where, you know, I would not want to read this Ayurveda proverb, but it clearly says when diet is wrong, medicine is of no use. And when diet is correct, medicine is of no need. And I think that is very relevant in today's scenario. And in addition to all of this, the veterinary medicine, as you had rightly pointed it out, because medicinal plants are not used only for human welfare, it is also used for its own welfare, that is crop welfare, and as well as animal health. And we are also looking forward towards expanding the TKDL database towards, you know, veterinary medicine. And perhaps this would also help us address issues of drug resistance. So with this, I would like to thank you once again for giving me the opportunity. Thank you very much, Professor Shankar.
Thank you very much, Vishwajanani. That was a very inspiring presentation. And I'm sure that the audience has been struck by the brilliant vision that is envisaged in future for TKDL in relation to drug discovery, in relation to personalized medicine, in relation to food. I think these are all going to be very, very important. And we hope that the BSA office and the National Biodiversity Mission can work closely with TKDL in the promotion of the mission, the biodiversity mission, and its component relating to medicinal plants. Thank you very
much. I look forward to that, Professor Shankar. I look forward.
Thank you very much. May I now invite the third speaker of the webinar, Varnita Mathur. And Varnita Mathur is a systems architect working in the MetaString Foundation. And she is designing this citizens portal on medicinal plants as part of the National Biodiversity Mission. So may I request Varnita to give us a brief presentation of the perspective and the architecture of this citizens portal on medicinal plants of India. Varnita, can you unmute her, please?
Thank you for the invitation. Hello, everyone. So without ado, I'll just start on. So what we are designing as part of our collaboration with the TDU and as part of the National Mission on Biodiversity and Human Wellbeing is a citizens portal on medicinal plants of India. India has a very rich heritage of traditional medicine and the use of medicinal plants for health and well-being, as we've seen in the last couple of presentations. It is part of our Ayurvedic heritage, as well as a living tradition being kept alive across generations. Our Ayurvedic heritage in terms of our Samhitas, Nigandhus, and so on. There's been a tireless effort over the years to systematically database this information and make it available to citizens and scientists alike. We already saw a couple of presentations about how this information, this knowledge base, is being systematically databased. And organizations like we just saw, TDU, CIKS, TKDL, and Honeybee Network have been building databases on medicinal plants and classical knowledge, as well as folk traditions. As part of the precursor grant to the National Biodiversity Mission, and the India Biodiversity Portal and TDU have initiated work on the development of a citizens portal on medicinal plants of India. It will consolidate all medicinal plants databases built at TDU since 2001 and integrate it with the medicinal plant species taxonomy, description, and spatial distribution. There are three main goals of this particular project that we're working on. One is to design a unified and scalable data model and modular architecture for medicinal plants. This should contain separate and interchangeable modules for species information, their Dravyaguna characteristics, formulations and preparation details, and details of usage. Information objects must be supported and substantiated with the knowledge holder, and there should be a possibility of data interexchange. The second goal is to organize and systematize the namespace of medicinal plants. So medicinal plant users do not have access to reliable information on taxonomic identities of medicinal plants of India. And there is a need to correlate plant synonyms in classical Ayurveda, Siddha, and other methods of other sources of information with regional and vernacular nomenclature, and then build a robust structure for classical botanical names with basonyms and synonymy, and build a vernacular name system for common names. This is the second goal of the project. And the third is to build a collaborative and participative knowledge platform for different stakeholders. These stakeholders will include knowledge domain experts, folk healers, traditional healers of local health and local health experts, scientists, biologists, IPR managers, and obviously citizens. So the requirement is for a comprehensive, flexible, and extensible data model that can integrate the species information. Species information, that is, you know, the biology, ecology, the botanical nomenclature, conservation status, distribution, habitats of the plants themselves. Essentially, their spatial distributions, as well as botanical information. Then the classical and the vernacular synonymy of medicinal plants, the classical framework of medicinal plants, as in the Dravyaguna karma properties and so on, the usage of medicinal plants in different systems of medicine and their references in various literatures, like classical literatures, scientific studies on validation of traditional practices, and ethnic or local health traditions. The usage of medicinal plants, again, in different targets, as in human health, animal health, and plant health, like what we call Pashu Ayurveda and Vriksha Ayurveda, and the modern pharmacological properties of various medicine plants. So all these things need to be described in a unified data model, and that is one of the goals of this particular project. This flexible and extensible data model will be the backbone of the citizens portal on medicinal plants. We have identified some basic constructs which can serve as conceptual modules for this model. One is the species profile model. This is an extensive model to describe the botanical information of species, as well as information about their distribution, habitats, and things like that. It has been used in the Encyclopedia of Life, and it has been extended with a system of traits and properties. The second basic construct is that a plant and a plant part is an ingredient and or what we call dravya in Ayurveda, and the formulations derived from them. These whole constitute a very important construct, and this is another conceptual module that we would explain in the data model. The third thing is the usage of these ingredients and formulations. Again, these usages vary across different health traditions in terms of whether they are used for human, animal, or plant health, and we should be able to describe these clearly and consistently. Other thing is what kind of usage is it, as in preventive, promotive, curative, and so on. And those should also be part of the data model. The third thing is a system of substantiation for these usages. This is a very important construct. As in our folk traditions, scientific studies, the classical literature that we have that reference these medicinal plants and the usages of these medicinal plants should find a location in this data model. The fourth thing are the users and the stakeholders. The users and stakeholders are people who have different roles. They would interact with the citizens portal in different roles. As in, there'll be scientists, there'll be IPR holders, there'll be citizens, there'll be folk healers, community leaders, and even businesses and institutions. So each one of these would need to look at this citizens portal and the data contained in it from a different perspective. And the series of roles and permissions, as well as the way we arrange the data, should allow this reimagining, of the data by different people based on their perspectives. So those are the imperatives driving the data model. This is a general architecture that we are following for the citizens portal. We are developing it, we're planning to develop it as a series of microservices. The reason for that is that it is an evolving, growing platform. It is a citizens portal, and therefore it will grow and evolve as people perceive it. So we need a very flexible, scalable architecture, which arranging it as microservices allows us. But more importantly, are the different database constructs that we are going to use in creating this architecture. The botanical information about different medicinal plants, their observations, the observations as in the spatial information or the geographical references of medicinal plants, and the descriptions, as in habits, habitats, and things like that, will be part of a specialized and interchangeable module called the species database. The Aushadhi database would describe the medicinal plant as an ingredient or a dravya, and its combinations of these dravyas as formulations or aushadhis with specific traits of their own, some of which are things like dravya guna, karma, and so on, and also their pharmacology. So this would be the world of, or the database of Aushadhi, and would be served over the portal by a specific microservice. The third would be a Prayoga service, which would contain a database of what we are calling Prayogas, which is basically the usages of medicinal plants. These usages can be looked at from different perspectives, whether it is from the perspective of a target in terms of animal health, human health, or plant health, or whether you're looking at it from the perspective of what kind of prayoga it is, as in whether it's a promotive, preventive, or curative prayoga. Also, the third thing is, where is this prayoga being defined from, or where is it being sourced from? Where is the substantiation for this prayoga coming from? And that is the those things are things like local health traditions, or classical literature, or different systems of medicine. These substantiations would constitute part of our references services, meaning the database which would contain all the references which substantiate these aushadhis, these species, and these all the information that is contained in the Prayoga microservices. We also have plans to put in a MedPlant trade module and a healers network module. Also, the advantage this kind of architecture gives us is a kind of encapsulation of this data in such a way that when we want to extend it, when we want to create new constructs around these things, it makes it much easier for us. And then an integrating product layer, which allows us to serve this information over an interactive portal, such that people can interact with it, with this information, in whichever way they want to. That is the whole idea behind having a citizen's portal. So I'll come to this collaborative and participative platform. The idea is to allow different stakeholders to be able to access and interact with the medicinal plants data that we will collect and that we will aggregate from different sources. Firstly, obviously, the TDU databases and so on, but eventually this should become a very interactive platform. And for that, so for example, these are the different communities or individuals who would interact with it. So communities and individual practitioners across India who are, a lot of them are conservators of this mature knowledge base of traditional medicine. They can share this knowledge while ensuring access and benefit sharing and affirming intellectual property rights. And a citizen's portal can unlock the potential of this knowledge in terms of livelihoods, entrepreneurial opportunities, as well as providing health and wellness security. Then traditional knowledge organizations like TDU can contribute content, validate knowledge, and collaborate with each other over the unified structure by developing data inter-exchange mechanisms. Folk healers can contribute content and share their knowledge. They can be properly attributed for their contributions and can benefit from information about the local availability of plants and ingredients. That would be that would be another advantage to local practitioners of this knowledge. Citizens. So citizens can look at this as a first level or preventive or promotive level. Example, if I have a condition and I want to see what is the locally available herbal remedy for it, I should be able to find it here, because the medicinal plants are referenced by their geographical availability or distribution, as well as by vernacular nomenclature, as well as by their usage in various systems of medicine. So if you want to know what are the local flora that are available for you to handle that ailment, you should be able to get that medicinal plant and find out its usages. Researchers obviously can use it for drug discovery, conservation science, and studying ethnobotanical usages of these medicinal plants. And of course, there are uses for business and enterprise in drug discovery, bioprospecting, and I won't go into this, the state as in enabling EPBR and conservation, enforcing the Biodiversity Act, as somebody is going to speak about it later. But essentially, this is the plan for the for a participative platform for medicinal plants of India. This being developed with the India Biodiversity Portal, which is already a participative and collaborative platform for species information. And therefore, there's a wealth of experience that comes with it. I think that's about it on this.
Thank you. Thank you, Varnita. I want to thank you for this clear, lucid presentation. I'm sure there will be questions that are already there in the question and answer thing. So we go on now to the last speaker. We are running a little short of time. So because we haven't been able to stick really to the 10 minutes allotted. No one has done it, not just you. So I think only Vishwa Janani probably kept that time. Can we come to the last speaker, Atul Gupta? Atul?
Yes. Kareem, Dr. Kareem, can you upload the presentation? Can I stop, sir?
Yes, please.
Good evening, everybody. Let me first of all thank the organizers for giving me this great platform to share certain aspects about medicinal plants and basically dealing with the conservation and how we can take this medicinal plant conservation through this NBM forward. So talking about the conservation of medicinal plants, well, each one of us know that as a generic term, conservation is very, very important. But when we specifically talk about the medicinal plants, we can say for sure that if we have the conservation mechanisms at place for the medicinal plants, we are having then a good gene pools of certain such medicinal plants, which we can call or refer as a prioritized medicinal plants with three different traits. Number one, which is most important currently, is the high volume trait species. 242 of such HVTs, which are traded for more than 100 metric ton quantity, are there currently known. And then second and third categories are the endemic species and the threatened, as per the IUCN categorization, which, as we all know, that critically endangered and vulnerable, these endangered, these constitute the threatened species. So if we conserve medicinal plants, we are assured of a gene pools of such prioritized species, which are going to be very, very important for us to have. Unless we have those, we will not have anything left as of now, because we know that because of the consumption or the trade of the species there is a lot of unsustainable harvesting. Then we have the forest areas and the wildlife areas getting converted into non-forest areas, getting degraded, so on and so forth. So these are the reasons which make the species susceptible to conservation. And these gene pools then in turn make available to us for selection and breeding activities, for providing reproductive material for planting purposes, which again very, very important to have sustained presence of certain medicinal plant species. So these are the conservation imperatives in short. Talking about two terms which are very common, yet I'm sorry to say that not very clearly understood: conservation and cultivation, or conservation versus cultivation. Now, if I say that, I think we can very, very effectively say that both are complementary to each other, because conservation, an effective conservation program, will act as a backbone for sustainable cultivation. Because for cultivation, as I said earlier in my previous slide, that if the species is conserved effectively, then it's going to provide a good genetic source, a planting material, a cultivation source for cultivation. And similarly, cultivation or plantations alone cannot ensure survival of a species, because as it relies on selected cultivars, which are going to come from the conserved species in wild or in their natural habitat. Because as we all know that a species in its natural habitat undergo quite a lot of rigors of environment and climate changes, and the species is bound to adapt itself. And that is what it is important, that we have a genetic variations of different species, and that is possible only when we conserve them in their natural habitat or natural areas. So this conservation and cultivation are both complementary, both are important. And why cultivation? Because cultivation is sometimes said to be also very important, because it provides a kind of a best way to provide the plant material needed for medicine, far better than collecting from the wild, because it protects depletion of wild stock. And in case of rare, endangered, and overexploited MPs, cultivation appears to be the only one best ways to supply medicinal plants. Although it is said also that wild harvested resources of medicinal plants are widely considered more efficacious than those that are cultivated. Domestic cultivation is a widely used and generally accepted practice. Wild collected medicinal plants may vary in quality and composition due to environmental and other genetic differences, and these variations can be reduced through cultivation. So both conservation is important. Without conservation, we cannot have cultivation, effective cultivation, and vice versa. So we must work very closely and very effectively to have these two things, scenarios ensured. Next, please. Talking about the conservation of medicinal plants, like we have for wildlife, we have national parks, sanctuaries, and then we have biosphere reserves. Then we have other conserved areas like community conserve areas, which are created for providing conservation cover to many wildlife species. Similarly, for medicinal plants, we have the medicinal plant conservation areas, which are created to conserve the medicinal plants. And as of now, we have got 212 MPCAs broadly categorized into two based on the one who undertook the creation of these. Now, FRLHT and TDU, right from 93 onwards till 2017, have come up with 110 MPCAs in 21 different states. And National Medicinal Plant Board on its own have created so far 102. And that is how we have 212 MPCAs. India has also a credit that it has standardized conservation assessment and management prioritization. Now, there is a process called CAM, which is used for declaring certain area as a MPCA. This is a well laid out, very effective and objective exercise, which has various processes like pre-camp for a day and then main camp exercise for 3 to 4 days, and then also follow up as a post-camp exercise. And this exercise is conducted with all possible stakeholders, which are going to have some or the other stake in the management or conservation of the medicinal plants, either their use or conservation, right from local people to local vaidyas, to the forest staff, to researchers, to industrial people, NGOs, citizens, so on and so forth. So all these, and then land department officials who are concerned with the medicinal plants. So all these different stakeholders are taken on board, and through a very rigorous process, which is called camp exercise, these MPs are conserved inside the MPCAs. And Camp India outputs, you know, are also being accepted because these are so rigorously conducted by the IUCN for their global listing of threatened medicinal taxa. So we have, India has standardized this process, which is very, very important. And even some more changes, some more new changes with the advent of new informations, we are going to practice that. Here is a map of a distribution map of MPCAs. This is only telling about the MPCAs which had been created by the TDU and FRLST. As you see, these are spread in south, west, east, northeast, and north. So very almost 21 states, as I said, are covered, and few are more in the maybe in the future through this national mission. We are going to have more of such MPCAs created in those areas where those states where not a single MPCA is there. And also through an NMPB, an NBM program, there is a program that we have to, we have 5 states where in each state we have to have these 3 MPCA per state. So we are going to have 15 MPCA further created in 5 states using this NBM platform. As I said that we are evolving and so are the processes. And two major approaches or innovations which we are going to take up through this NBM are, one is that the triangulation of HVT, that is high volume traded species, threatened and endemic species, prioritization of future MPCAs. As I told that the first exercise started with Danida, my way back in 1993, where even we were not having a complete list of medicinal plants in those states where these MPCAs were created. And also till 2015, remaining when MPCAs were created, even there also, we were not having very perfect listing of HVTs, threatened and endemic species. Now we have got all these listing. So a triangulation of these 3 different traits of a medicinal plant, using these, we are going to have a prioritization of future MPCAs, which we feel that will be more effective and more objective for different users. And second innovation which we are planning in the MPCAs is the use of genetic and plant microbiome diversity studies, which will help us to deepen scientific value of MPCAs program. As we know that genetic diversity and plant microbiome both play a very important role for letting us know the intra-specific species variations, especially genetic diversity and plant microbiome. As we know that plants and these microbiome have evolved together with each other, and their presence, especially the endophyte microbiomes, are very, very important also in the production of these metabolites and the secondary metabolites, which are again very important for the purpose of industrial purposes. So all these 2 new knowledge bases are also going to be used as an innovation in the forthcoming National Biodiversity Mission Program. So with this, I end my brief talk. Thank you.
The floor is now open for question and answers. I'm sorry that we are shooting a little bit beyond the scheduled time, But let's start with question and answers. I have received some questions. There's a question to Dr. Shastri from G. Hariram Murthy. Is Dr. Shastri there?
Yeah.
So the question is, since there was an earlier scheme in NMPB wherein NGOs and CBOs working with scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, etc., could avail of NBM of NMPB support, is this scheme still valid? Is the question?
Yeah, it is still valid. See, only thing earlier it was the center-sponsored scheme when it comes to cultivation. Today it is a NAM scheme.
So that means that NGO. The answer is that we can still get support from NMPB for such kind of activity which NGOs and CBOs working with scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, etc.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
In fact, for scheduled caste, there is a special fund, and this speaks depending upon that individual state's scheduled caste population, the funds will be allocated, and many times they are not utilized to the fullest of the strength.
Okay, this is another question which is addressed to Varnita. Is the citizens portal likely to be available in vernacular languages and supported by GS, GIS and voice interactions? Can citizens make entries of their own knowledge onto the portal? Varnita.
That is the eventual goal, that it has to be an interactive platform that citizens' knowledge, as in whether they are experts or non-experts, should find a way into this database.
Okay. I think there was a question which she has already answered, Vishwajanini, which was about documentation of local health practices, not only the codified systems, whether that is on the agenda of TKDL. And I think the answer was given in the presentation itself, but would you like to add anything?
Yeah, we are considering it actively. We are trying to put some certain formalities in place, such as a free and prior informed consent requirement, and as well as there have been certain questions raised on the access benefit sharing of such knowledge with the knowledge holders. So we are putting in place all these required procedural formalities so that we can then take up oral traditional knowledge documentation within the TKDL database.
There is another question about is there any regulatory mechanism to monitor and regulate the citizen science platforms like iNaturalist? I don't know who could answer this question. This was not referred to in the presentation, but Neeta, would you have something to say on this citizen science
platform? They all should be governed by Indian laws, the Biodiversity Act, the NDSAP. I don't have anything more on that.
Okay. Question to Dr. Shastri. That there was a very good point about enforcing access and benefit sharing. And involvement of CSR contributions. Would you like to elaborate a little bit on this?
Absolutely. In fact, we have made a representation to NBA also. NBA being part of NBA. In the upcoming programs, we made it clear the major component of Nagoya Protocol, on the basis of which we made the ABS regulations, speaks about non-monetary benefit sharing than monetary benefit sharing. And the CSR component of each of these major companies it will contribute a lot, and which we were not focused. We were in India. We were only focused, and we are going to focus only on the monetary benefit sharing, which is meager amounts, if you ask me. And I have given the calculations. It will be a fourfold increase, if you believe me, in the ABS contributions. So if we go for a non-monetary benefit sharing, than only looking at monetary benefit sharing.
Probably that's right, and because you know the monetary benefit sharing is so limited, I see what you're saying. There is a question to TKDL to elaborate on, you know, what is their vision of using artificial intelligence to improve the searchability or, you know, integration synergy of data in TKDL. Could you elaborate on that?
Sure, Professor Shankar. The TKDL database, as I had mentioned, is a very structured database. It is built on metadata, which is the TKRC, that is the traditional knowledge resource classification codes. And every of these TKRC codes, which forms the metadata, is a searchable component in the database. So what we are looking at is that, you know, moving forward, when we are modernizing and upgrading the current ICT infrastructure of the TKDL, it should be amenable to machine learning as well as the artificial intelligence methods. And it would actually, you know, as I had mentioned, it would enable us to go forward.
How am I going to search?
Yeah, it would enable us to do the required searches in terms of, you know, say either by disease or by medicinal plants, you know, be whatever is the criteria. It could be even by the formulation, it could be by the ingredient, if in case you're talking of, you know, polyherbal formulations. So there are many ways in which this machine learning and AI can be enabled, and we are looking forward to enable it in the future course of our work in TKDL.
Thank you, Vishwajanini. I think that in terms of the time we had set for this webinar, which was 75 minutes, we have more or less completed that time. And so I would like to now close the seminar with just very, very few summary kind of a thing, because the speakers have been so explicit in their presentations. I mean, the only remark that I'd like to make is that I do think that in future, the National Medicinal Plant Board, the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library, initiatives like the Citizens Portal, initiatives like the electronic PBR that the NBA itself is now developing, most of these initiatives are focused, of course, on medicinal plants. Now, many people don't realize that the medicinal plant heritage of this country is really very, very extensive. I mean, first of all, in forest areas, 40 to 70% of wild flora has been discovered to have medicinal value by communities. That's the largest proportion of forest flora for any particular use. Of course, the medicinal use may be for human, may be for animal, or it may be for agriculture. There's no doubt that already medicinal plants support, to whatever extent they do, health security of citizens. Initiatives like the rich data that is there in TKDL, the efforts on health security and livelihood security, and the kind of end-to-end from seed to shelf sort of link-ups that NMPB is thinking of, very bold vision. And I think that the initiative that the PSA's office is promoting on a special component in the National Biodiversity Mission on medicinal plants are definitely definitely going to serve multiple stakeholders. I expect that the largest beneficiary will be ordinary citizens who may be benefited by way of solutions for primary healthcare needs, farmers who may be supported with effective solutions for managing livestock health and the health of their own crops. But there will also be organized stakeholders, and there should be organized stakeholders in research communities, in scientists, and with the vision that is there for drug discovery, using technologies like artificial intelligence, projections of things like personalized medicine, which is a great application of traditional knowledge. I think we should look forward in this country to the traditional valorizing the traditional knowledge of medicinal plants in a very, very contemporary way in the 21st century. So I thank the speakers. I thank the sponsors of this webinar. I thank the participants who have participated in this. And with all your permission, I may sign off. The next webinar is on the 6th of October, the same time. And I already mentioned the title of it. So please enjoy the biodiversity conversations that are being promoted by NBA, by the Prime Minister's Science Advisory Office, Principal Scientific Advisor's Office, and the Biodiversity Collaborator. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ji.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.